Last fall, the Oregonian featured a series by Judy Rooks on women making the corporate climb. A place in the boardroom means you've reached the top. It's from this lofty level that management's performance is monitored, company policy and direction is set, and stockholders are represented. Many boardroom seats carry a retainer fee of several thousand dollars, plus compensation for each meeting attended. This makes the seats even more attractive. But as reporter Rooks turned to the corporate boardroom, she discouragingly noted, "The decade-long rush to appoint women directors appears to have ended. The majority of the nation's corporate boardrooms remain all men." And here at Oregon, it's not much different. Less than two dozen women have been elected to board service on Oregon's major public corporations. The National Women's Economic Alliance reports that nationally, the proportion of seats held by women remains under 10%. Furthermore, these positions are concentrated in the service industries. The greatest numbers are found in insurance, banking, and financial services. Women are noticeably absent from boards of high-tech, forest products, and heavy manufacturing companies. These industries remain a male-dominated world. Today, City Club wants to follow up on that series. We've invited three of Portland's outstanding women who serve on corporate boards to talk about how they got there, what it's like to be there, and once there, the difference they make. To my far right is Marsha Congdon, Oregon Vice President and Chief Executive Officer of Pacific Northwest Bell. She's been with U.S. West Systems for 13 years and in Oregon since February of 87. Her service on Oregon nonprofit boards includes the Oregon Business Council, OMSI, Oregon Symphony, and the Oregon Independent College Foundation. She's also a fellow of the American Leadership Forum. Currently, Ms. Congdon serves as director of Valco, a manufacturing company, Valmont, a publicly traded high-tech farm equipment company, and Frambo, a business development consulting firm. Next is Nancy Wilgenbusch, president of Marylhurst College since July of 84. She's active in civic affairs, including board service on the Portland and Lake Oswego Chambers of Commerce, Portland Urban League, and Junior Achievement. She's both a founder and a fellow of the Oregon chapter of the American Leadership Forum. Dr. Wilgenbusch holds the distinction of being the only woman to serve on the board of a Nebraska company listed on the New York Stock Exchange, Mutual of Omaha Fund Management Company. In addition, she was recently appointed to the board of Oregon's Pacific Corp. On my left is Gwyneth Gamble Booth, reporter, producer, and co-anchor for Oregon Public Broadcasting's Front Street Weekly, and longtime contributor to Portland's Civic Health. Her past nonprofit board service includes such organizations as Artquake, Oregon Heart Association, Reed College, DePaul Center, and the Oregon Symphony. Currently, she serves on the board of the Oregon Community Foundation, American Advertising Museum, and the American Heart Association's Dant Fund. Ms. Booth has served on the Oregon Physician Services Board and was the first woman elected to Portland General Electric's Board of Directors. Her service on PGE's board continues today. Let's turn to these women and find out how they came to be appointed. Gwyneth, we'll let you start.
In thinking about why I was appointed to the board of Portland General Corporation and PGE, I would have to begin with the thought that perhaps on my part it was chutzpah when it came to approaching the enlightened CEO, and I would add that it was probably the fact that the CEO was enlightened. But why has this thrust on the part of major corporations to put qualified women on their boards lessened? along with what Mary mentioned in Judy Rook's article, it has certainly all but diminished. And I would suggest to you that with the exception of a very few enlightened CEOs, most corporation heads picked women for boards, myself included, in 1981, to appease the feminist movement. Those women who were also shareholders in their companies and demanded to be represented. And does this mean that women have not continued to be a force in the corporate world? I would say to you, probably it does. But to go back to why I was chosen to be a board member of Portland General Corporation, I'd like to digress for a minute and say that I think that the education of men on boards has come quite a long way in the past decade. Indeed, I was told when I was asked to go on this board that there was a man on the board who had said in a public meeting that the day that PGE has a woman on its board is the day I resign. Well, I can tell you that he is still on the board, and somehow the company hasn't fallen apart. We're still there. But to give you some idea of how I started, because for many of you who are successful in a career that takes you outside of your home, which is not to denigrate that career that is inside the home, you did this right out of college or right out of some experience immediately after college. For me, my career began after having my children and getting them all into school and realizing that there had to be life after the PTA. And with that in mind, I decided that I would involve myself to a greater extent in the community. And thus I found myself on boards, some art boards, and some boards that dealt with issues. And this was how I met the CEO of Portland General. And I remember speaking with him. First of all, I should tell you that it has never occurred to me that women were not as capable as their male counterparts. And perhaps that gave me the word I began with, the chutzpah, to say to him, "Why do you not have a woman on your board?" I see that I have 15 seconds left, but I would say to you that probably why I was picked was that I had a communications background. I was in the right place at the right time. There was an enlightened CEO, and it was the time to put women on boards. But I'll come back to that later. Thank you, Mary.
Thank you, Gwyneth. Marsha, what was your path to the corporate boardroom?
Well, I think that companies today are viewing who they put on corporate boards in a little more strategic kind of a sense as they look at their business. In other words, I think that a lot of businesses face a lot of competition, and as companies begin to understand that they really need people who have unique sets of skills and abilities on their board, they begin to look around at who is available out there with those unique sets of skills and abilities. I had a technical background. I do have a technical background, and I had experience in rural America and served on in a nonprofit board that was designed to bring high technology into rural America. So when a particular company that was looking for some kind of a development of high tech in the rural area looked at the skills and abilities of people that they needed on boards, on their board specifically, somebody mentioned me as having those skills and ability, and they recruited me. I think that corporations today need to be much, much more careful about whom they put on the boards. Again, because the economy has expanded into a global economy, we have worldwide competition, and businesses are facing challenges that they've never faced before. I am not quite as down about this as Judy Rooks is, because I think as a cadre of women begin to appear in the workplace who are developing unique sets of skills and abilities and have educated themselves, have experiences behind them that lead them to have the kinds of skills and abilities that corporations are looking for, I think that you will see more women coming onto boards. One thing that I will tell you I am very proud of and failed to mention, I'm on Nancy's board. And one way to get on a board is to have a woman as the head. That they seem to put women on their board. But the other thing that I would mention, just a process that we use in selecting board members, is we lay out a matrix of who is on the board, what kind of skills we need as we look forward to governing our business for the next 10 to 20 years, and then we kind of fill in the blanks. Who currently on the board has that skill, and what skills don't we have? And I think as women prepare themselves to go on boards, if they can take that kind of approach of developing unique sets of skills and abilities, I think that's the path.
Thank you, Marsha. Nancy, let's hear from you.
Well, unlike my two colleagues, I'm not real certain why I was put on the two boards I'm on. And I had a lot of problem, quite frankly, trying to determine some things that I could put down here on this paper that make sense to those of you who aspire to be on corporate boards. So I'm going to guess, and then I'm going to tell you the real answer here in a minute. I think it's the same set of reasons why anybody would be chosen to serve on the not-for-profit boards as well. And I'm going to list three of those that I think were important in my determination. One was being visible in the community through my career over a period of years. I think visibility has a lot to do with men or women being chosen to serve on boards. Secondly, I had gained a certain amount of professional recognition. Now, I'm not saying whether that was good or bad, but I was recognized within my profession, both outside the organization as well as inside the organization. And I was involved in the community in a number of humanitarian issues that added to that visibility in the community as well. And I also, I think there's some importance to the fact that I had some experience and credibility in strategic planning and finances, and I think that that helped as well. There's two other areas I want to add to that that I'm not real certain that I'm going to describe it quite right, but I think they're two very important reasons. One is a willingness to serve. I think that the community that is assessing people to go on boards has to really be assured that a person is willing to serve. And I don't mean willing to serve just in the corporate board sense, where it's fun to serve and all that, but almost the servant kind of an attitude that a person must bring to the community in order to be chosen to serve on any board, whether it's profit or nonprofit. And the second thing there is a willingness to lead, a willingness to talk about a vision, to lead people toward a vision, a willingness to bring people together to solve common problems in the community. And I think those two things are as important as a unique set of skills and abilities that I'm not quite so certain that I can delineate what those might be. So I had this all written down. I shared that with you. Then I picked up the phone and called Don Frisbee over at PacifiCorp. He's CEO, chairman of the board, and I'm sure Don had a lot to do with me being named to the PacifiCorp board. And I called up Don this morning, in fact, about 10 minutes before I walked out of the office, and I said, "Don, quick, I've got to go out to a panel on, you know, City Club. Why did I get chosen to serve on your board?" And Don quickly said, "Number one, proven leadership and administrative ability. Number two, background in financial matters. Number three, the ability to perceive the role of an organization in the total community responsiveness kind of thing." And he says, "Lastly, and importantly, you're a woman." I said, "Thank you, sir, very much."
Thank you, Nancy. We're going to turn to each of our panelists now and get them to answer a question in depth, and then we'll see if the other two agree or disagree or can add any comments. So we'll start with Nancy, because one of the questions that comes up again and again is, what role does academic training play in preparing women to serve on corporate boards? And does our culture support that or not? Do we need to make any changes? Nancy?
Thank you, Mary. I'm going to divide this into two sections and make my comments go in one direction academically and culturally and separate those two out for separate concerns. First of all, as Mary's pointed out, it's obvious that women are not being accepted into the corporate boardroom very rapidly. Right now, she said under 10% is 3% out of 16,000 directors in the nation. Only 480 are outside directors of corporate organizations. Obviously, that's a shame when we're over 50% of the population. and also that the road to a corporate directorship, statistically, is through the position of a CEO. In other words, CEOs are chosen by other CEOs to serve on their boards of directors. So the importance of academic training, vis-a-vis college majors, would be in direct correlation to whatever role those majors happen to play determining who the CEOs will be. Currently, 36% of CEOs or CEO contenders in America have MBA degrees, and another 24% have other types of master's degrees. So, and additionally, my experience tells me, and I don't know, I'd like to hear from my colleagues on this, my experience is that a large number of CEOs have degrees in business, economics, finance, engineering, accounting, something along those lines. So in terms of academic issues, I would say that the best preparation would be to gain at least a master's degree in your field of interest. And while certain majors are predominant at the CEO levels from where the pool is that you're chosen from, I would say that the person need not be restricted by majors. My major in college has nothing to do with either of these, and neither does the other woman on the board that serves with me at PacifiCorps. However, I think that education can and should and will play an increasing role in respect to educating people to assume leadership positions in our community. For all types of roles of leadership, both profit and nonprofit. And I think that within this matrix, education has a very important role in relationship to ethics, for instance. Helping leaders develop a philosophical belief system from which decisions about our community and the corporations within that community are made. Also, people need to be well-rounded. So, of course, I'm high on liberal arts education. I think we need to know math. We need to be good communicators. All of that embedded within a sound, very sound education. That's what I'd say about education in relationship to the cultural role. And what role does our culture play in that is a different story. American culture, both social and organizational, is currently working against women being placed in the corporate boardroom. The directors for boards are usually identified by the corporate executives, which for the most part are men. And because there's a comfort level and a trust level established between and among men, the choice is usually for a man that has easily recognizable skills, abilities, and attitudes. Women who are known entities with tested competencies and significant amounts of credibility and who are also the executive or CEO ranks are few and far between. Thus, women, I think, are seldom chosen. The problem is this. Directors are chosen from CEO ranks, and there are precious few women there to choose from. In fact, out of the Fortune 500 companies today, there's one woman, CEO among those 500. And out of the nation's group of corporate officers that are in the pipeline toward the CEO position, only 1.7% of those are women. The answer to more women in the boardroom, then, is to get more women to the top executive levels, or to convince the top male executives to consider other categories of competent people. So what I'm going to say, I think that women can enhance their opportunities on boards in four ways. One, continuing to assume positions of leadership in the community. Two, by being willing to hold positions of significant accountability and by being tested and by being successful when you're tested. Three, by gaining professional recognition within and outside your organizations via publishing, public speaking, professional associations, and so forth. And last, by gaining a reputation for predictable and consistent competency.
Thank you, Nancy. Gwyneth and Marsha, any comments to add?
Well, Nancy just about wrapped it up.
Well, also, I feel pleased with the fact that we have a woman in a very high position at Portland General. Many of you know Kay Stepp, so we have not only an enlightened CEO who has promoted the cause of women, because I would certainly agree with you, Marsha, that when I think boards are put together or people are chosen for boards, very often it is the desire, it's the wish of the CEO, and I think we are blind if we don't realize that. And what does he look for? He looks, first of all, for other CEOs, other women in top management positions. So I guess I would give Portland General at least an A+, because we are in the process of doing that.
Okay. Thank you. Let's turn to the corporate boardroom and take a look at their culture. Do they have a culture all of their own or a personality all of their own? And what does it take for a woman to gain credibility in that kind of a culture? Are they in on the deals that are made, and are the deals made in the room or outside of the room? What goes on there? Gwyneth?
Gosh, I thought they were made at the Arlington Club. Where am I going? I am being facetious. However, I would suggest to women in the room that if you think there is an old girls network, I think you are mistaken. We have not gotten to that point. And until, again, we have more women on the top of the management level, there will not be a girls network. But to get back to the idea of a culture in the corporate boardroom, I would suggest that the culture of corporate life in the boardroom is really no different than the culture on any not-for-profit board that is active, that is doing what it should be doing, and that is being responsible, in this case, to its shareholders, if you are a corporation board as we are, or being responsible to those people who depend upon the nonprofit board to carry out what the institution should be doing. I think that what does it take to get credibility was one of the questions that you wanted me to address. And going back to something Nancy said, I think that part of the way women get credibility on a corporate board is to prove themselves on nonprofit boards. I think serving as I did as a trustee of Reed College, which is a business, and a very important business in that sense, gave me credibility in a business sense. I think also the fact that my background, while it was not business, was in communications also gave me credibility for a business, because it seems to me that major corporations have been looking around at their communities and realizing that they needed to be responsible to many of the community needs and heretofore had not been. So again, in my case as a communicator, this was an invaluable resource. I want to stress today something I alluded to initially, and that is that for women to succeed on the corporate level, they have got to think of themselves as capable people first and women second. You men don't have a problem with this, but we seem to, and I think it's a cultural thing that has been with us probably since the beginning of time. But until we can put aside that gender question and really feel that, of course, we are as capable as our male counterparts, we are still going to be left in the dust. So with that, I will add that if I see this common failing among members of my gender, it's that too often we forget that once we have made it up that corporate ladder, that we must reach out and help other women. And this seems to be a failing among women, not among men. We can help and the cause of each other. So I guess I would say if deals are really made inside the boardroom, it is that women are there and those who've made it have the chance to help other women. If you look around in this room at the successful women, you will see some things that they share in common. These women are good people managers. This is something that's very important to boardroom etiquette. I think women who are successful, whether they are on a nonprofit board or a corporation, for example, see a larger pattern. They're forthright, but they're polite. They're aware of and sensitive to and serious about the responsibilities of their constituencies and what it takes to be on that board. And most important of all, I have come to learn that when dealing on a corporate board, it is important to have a sense of humor and to be flexible.
Thank you, Gwyneth. Marsha and Nancy?
I would just follow up what Gwyneth had to say and reiterate the issue of flexibility. And boards really need to do their homework. And my experience has been that the best board members are the ones who come to a board meeting prepared and, quite frankly, understand the issues that the company is facing and are able to communicate on those issues and add thoughts and the ideas for which they were invited, for which those board members were invited to be on the board in the first place. there are some board members who don't view their participation in that manner, and it makes it very difficult for a board to function. So I think as anybody serving on a board, but particularly a woman serving on a board, you can really enhance your credibility by doing your homework, being flexible, and also being able to laugh at yourself. I think that is really important. And then working as a team and being willing to share. Understanding that a board is really a team, and being willing to share your thoughts, your ideas, and also some of the limelight for having made a decision on the board with the other people.
I think that Marsha said that very nicely, and just underscore the whole line of credibility, and to realize that just because you're a woman doesn't mean you're any more credible than a man. And you have to earn that credibility over a period of time of, again, consistent competency. And I'd like to underscore what Marsha said about that.
Marsha, if we took a look at the corporate minutes from the last 6 months and compared it with 6 months of 20 years ago, would we be able to tell that women have made a difference? And if they have, what kind of difference have they made?
Yes, I would say we would be able to tell that women had made a difference. And again, I go back to this issue of companies striving for excellence today. And when you are a corporation striving for excellence, you cannot afford to ignore 51% of the talent pool if you're trying to get the brightest and the best people on your board. So if there is 51% of the talent pool out there, you need to be able to access that talent pool and bring those people on your board. That talent pool, or bringing those people on the board, will begin to change how boards make decisions. And let me give you an example from my company, Pacific Northwest Bell. We have three women on our board, and that's just under 30% of the board is women. Several years ago, faced issues of what low pay for some of our customer contact jobs. One of the women on our board took a tack, and it was a very good tack, that you cannot afford to pay those customer contact jobs, the people who deal with your most important the most important part of your business, your customers, you cannot afford to pay those jobs at substandard wages because you really want to attract, again, the brightest and the best people to those jobs. She made that point over and over again. And incidentally, the jobs were held all by women primarily. We made that part of our union negotiations to raise the salaries of those women, and the salaries were raised. The interesting fallout on that is that now 50% of the applications to that job are males. Almost exactly 50% are males. And the other interesting fallout of that is that we don't accept anyone into those jobs who don't have college education and at least 2 years' experience dealing with customers. So we have significantly upgraded the people who are dealing with our customers. Let me give you a few statistics that I think are really interesting when you think about women on boards and think about do we need them and do they make a difference? Again, I said they're 51% of the talent pool. 49% of the shareholders in the United States, of the total shareholders in the United States, are women. Now that includes institutions, and institutional holders and male holders and women holders. So of the people or institutions that hold shares of stock in U.S. corporations, 49% of them are women. Women have about $3 trillion in disposable income that they control in the United States. That is a lot of money. Any corporation that looks out at representing their shareholders and being responsive to shareholders and then looks at being responsive to customers and ignores the fact that almost 50% of the shareholders in the U.S. are women, and women spend $3 trillion a year, and don't think, if the corporation doesn't think that they should put women on the boards and that women will make a difference, those corporations will be frankly, as we move forward into the 90s, we'll be left behind. And it's a real, corporations need to face up to that.
Thank you, Marsha. Nancy and Gwyneth, anything to add?
In terms of whether or not women have made a difference in the boardroom, it seems to me that going back to this idea of corporations being more responsive to the needs, perhaps one could call it the emotional needs of a community, I very much feel that the impact of women on boards has made this come about.
Nancy?
I couldn't add anything to that.
Okay. Great. Thank you very much, panelists. We'll now get the mic in the center of the room set up. And while they're doing that, we'll give our panelists a first question. Do you all anticipate that the numbers of women on corporate boards will increase or decrease in the 1990s? And what are the factors that are going to make it rise or fall?
Well, I think that Marsha's statistics count for a lot. Money speaks and speaks loud in our society, and that's going to do the biggest. I think that it will unquestionably rise, and it will rise, I think, for the right reasons. I think the skills and the abilities that we bring to that are very much needed in our corporations. I think those are going to be recognized. I think the sheer numbers of women, not only in the pipeline heading to upper reaches of management, will make a difference, and also the numbers of women in our working force in general. So unquestionably, there'll be way more women in the corporate boardroom by the year 2000 than there are today. Mm-hmm.
And also the number of women who are, again, the very thing you spoke of, Nancy, the number of women who make it to top management positions will be on corporate boards.
Nancy talked about education and the importance of education, and currently about 42% of the people enrolled in MBA courses in the United States are women, and as we move into the 90s, those people will begin to come out and populate corporations, and I don't see how there is any way, for the reasons that I stated earlier, and Nancy put succinctly, money speaks, and then the fact that the talent pool is just going to be there.
Thank you. Question from the floor.
I'm going to take advantage of the fact that I was right here. We've been talking about Pacific Northwest Bell, we've been talking about Portland General Electric. Everybody needs a telephone, and everybody needs electricity. And also, these two industries are regulated, but there are other large corporations. I'm thinking, for example, of an automobile manufacturer, someone like that. How is it different for an industry that is not regulated and that has to depend upon the whims of the public from an industry like the ones that you two ladies serve, where there's not a lot of choice?
I would love to take that one on.
Good.
Go for it.
Pay me.
Generally, consumer-oriented kinds of businesses are the ones that should be the most interested in having women on the board. Again, $3 trillion of disposable income being spent by women during 1987 is really significant. Automobiles have, and also those have not been on small ticket items. Women have become buyers of big ticket items. Last year they spent $35 billion on cars, bought 4 out of every 10 cars in the United States that were bought were purchased by women. I think corporations, if they're going to be responsive to their customers and going to meet the competition coming in across our borders all over for the consumer's dollar, really needs to put people on their board who represent all of their customers. And so I think the thrust will be much greater in consumer-oriented kinds of businesses. General Mills has about 32% of the people on the General Mills board are women. And that's a very consumer-oriented kind of a board or consumer-oriented company. I just really feel that as boards and corporations begin to face up to the fact that who is spending the money, you're going to see women on boards.
May I say one more thing to that? Your question was, how is a board which is a regulated industry different? I'm not really sure that there is that much difference. And I think that for those boards, say a major automobile corporation, which does not have a woman or women on the board, that we as women have a responsibility, and it would be nice if men joined us to say, why not? And make them answer.
Thank you. Yes, Jean.
Hi, I'm Jeannie Dodson-Edgars, and I have a question about boards, too. We're talking about public boards here, yet of all the businesses that are starting, there's small businesses of 50 employees or less, and of those, the majority of them are being started by women. And are there any statistics, or can you speak of women in boards on private corporations, private companies, how that's going to impact the public companies?
I'd like to ask you a question. Why do you think that is so? Why do you think that so many of these small businesses, what is it about our culture? I'm interested in what your answer is, because I just was talking to a young woman at public broadcasting about this. Why do you think so many of these small businesses are being started by women?
The opportunities for advancement are much faster
exactly.
if you start your own business.
Exactly. Women, by starting her own, a woman does not run into what is called the glass ceiling if she starts her own business. You're right.
So if you could speak on women in private boards. I happen to be on a board of a forest products industry company, which is a technology-based, and I have certainly contributed my perspective, which is a bit different than the two males on the board.
I also sit on the board of a privately held corporation, and I am very willing to contribute my perspective, and many times it's different than anyone else's perspective, I might add. In my opinion, the impact will be about the same, although, as you know, sitting on a private board, they are sometimes the exchanges are considerably more heated and the etiquette is considerably less decorous than on a publicly held board.
To say nothing of the culture.
I think that the publicly held boards, the board members, especially the outside directors, have a very highly visible fiduciary responsibility to the shareholders, and it makes you terribly accountable, and what you're really doing is voting in behalf of a million or so shareholders, and that's an awesome responsibility, both philosophically as well as legally.
Legally.
And that makes a difference. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Ray Polani, a member of the City Club. This increasingly interdependent and competitive world, does anybody of you know how we compare to the rest of the Western world, at least, in women in position of corporate decision making and so on? Or did I ask the wrong question?
No. I think that is really ironic because I think that obviously the United States, if you look at it from a global perspective, is considerably more advanced in this area than other countries. I think the issue then becomes how do we resource the most? How can we have as corporations, the biggest resource of talent available, and regardless of whether that talent is male or female or what race. And so I think the concern is not necessarily what is going on outside our country, but what we have to do inside our country to meet the competition.
So what we're really saying is there's an opportunity for leading again, isn't there?
I think that's exactly right.
Marilyn McDonald, City Club member. There are a lot of women in our community who have been outstanding leaders and have shown us the way to go to the top as far as boards or commissions or leadership in businesses are concerned. And I want to ask you to answer a question about letting the public know or letting the right people know that you are available to serve as one question for you to answer, and I'd also like to have us recognize Nancy Riles, who's here, and I think she has been an outstanding leader and a model for women in this community.
Mm-hmm. I think the competition among both men and women to serve on corporate boards. I mean, there's few positions numerically, and everybody would love to do that. So I think that to let yourself, let people know that you're available to serve on a corporate board might be interesting, but to earn your way to that is another story, and I think you earn that through, like I said earlier, a lot of credibility and hard work in the community as well as among your own profession. So I don't think that it would serve the women well of our community to think that if they all wrote letters to PNB and to Tektronix or whatever, that you will get necessarily placed on that. But it certainly, I think, makes sense to let people know what your skills are, to be visible in the community, and work hard for all the common good of our community.
And to ask questions about that board, if there is a specific board in which you are interested in, and all other things being equal, ask questions about it. Find out how that board operates, who is on that board. I think that's important.
Okay. Sarah Harlan, member of the club. In answer to the gentleman's request about what the rest of the world might be doing, let me offer that I met a woman from Sweden not long ago who set up her own business because she was told in Sweden as a corporate vice president that she would never advance any further in that company. Her business puts together United States companies and world companies with women to be directors who are knowledgeable in international finance, international marketing, international business aspects. And she was here to talk to Portland companies who have international facilities and give them names of women worldwide who
have
proven competence. Yes, my question is really information. If anyone in this room would like the name of this woman from Sweden, I will leave the name with the City Club.
Let's take one of the written questions at this point. Do you feel that a male mentor is an essential ingredient to a successful career for the corporate woman?
No. No, I do not. I think that it's very nice to have a male mentor in terms of perhaps advancement through the company. At PGC, for example, I'm sure that Kay Stepp would, in fact, she has said that Bob Short has been her mentor and has helped her in her management rise. But I think for a woman to have a male mentor on the board, it is not important. I think once on that board, she needs to prove her own effectiveness by her own strengths, by what she brings to the board, by, as Marsha mentioned, by doing her homework, by clearly understanding what the responsibility of that board is.
I think that a mentor, be they male or female, to anybody moving up in a corporation within that corporation is very important, frankly. And they can, in a very gentle way, show you where you might be making a mistake. They can also smooth openings for you. They can give you advice. And in the final analysis, I have had a couple of mentors in my career, and frankly, they have helped me considerably. If they were here, I would publicly thank them for everything that they had done for me, and it was very important. And I make that a real part of my business life, and that is to look at talented people coming through the business and help make their way a little easier. So I think it's important.
I had two mentors. One was a Catholic nun who cares nothing at all about finances and cares a lot about souls and has helped me tremendously. And the other was a highly irreverent, nasty man who helped me in a great many other areas, and I needed them both, and I certainly appreciate them.
Yes, from the floor.
I'm Charlotte Kennedy, and I have a question that digresses a little bit from the topic, but I think it's related to the influence of women who are on corporate boards. Women are known as fairly poor givers of political contributions and not terribly interested in being power brokers in the political process, at least at the national level. What difference does it make if more women come on corporate boards? Do they become more involved politically? Do you think they're likely to give more money, to be more influential in selecting state candidates or national candidates? Do any of you have any direct experience in that area?
Yes, I think it does. I think anybody on the board, when you suddenly realize that government affects how your business lives or dies, and that's for almost any business in this country, the board members do become more politically active, and if they are really thinking about the business. And I think women, we specifically have an obligation to support candidates that we believe in, and to support them financially and to be politically active.
I think that politics has a lot to do with how we do business. So depending on the business that you're in or what board you're on makes a big difference, and you have to be closely attuned to that.
And I think that your point, Charlotte, about women making financial contributions to, in other words, a woman putting her money where her mouth is when it comes to supporting a candidate. I don't know that corporate board involvement necessarily means that, but I think it's important for women to do.
Thank you. Next question.
Yes, Angel Pallotta, City Club member. First of all, I want to commend all you confident, visible women up there, and thank you. We like to see that. One of the questions I have is, I think we could probably get 100 women in this room that are extremely visible, very competent, and highly educated, yet we still don't have them in the boardrooms. And I think I want to ask the question, isn't the question still the comfort level that we're dealing with, and the fact that women possibly just don't have those connections to get there, even though the Oregonian reported that our CEOs felt more comfortable than the nationwide survey, although they did the survey on a person-to-person phone call. So anyway, that was my question.
Well, I think I addressed that to some degree, but I still think it goes back to women helping other women. And this is part of the network we don't have, but I think it is incumbent upon those of us who are on boards to keep pushing for other women board members. It takes time, but it is happening.
I think that comfort and trust established between and among people in general comes through test over time. You know, repeated tests of competency. And so there's faith built between people. And there's a simple fact that women haven't been at that CEO level enough to be tested and to gain people's trust in order to be put on that. So yes, it's comfort, but that comfort comes from more than just a male-female reaction. That comfort comes from having long associations with people in a lot of different circumstances. Women just haven't been at that top level enough to have men feel very comfortable with them under fire. That will come with time. And I think we can help that along. But I think there's just a basic lack of tested women.
Okay, we'll take another written question. Does it matter that the doors of the Arlington Club and the University Club are closed to women? How much and what kind of business is done in settings that exclude women?
Well, from my point of view, very little. But, you know. So, you know, I really can't answer it from anyone else's point of view, but I think, again, as women, the specific club you spoke of, I don't do business there. And and as there are more people, there are four of us sitting at this table who don't do business there, and probably 50% of this room doesn't. Just if I were the Arlington Club, I'd want to think about that.
I think that in 1988 in Portland, Oregon, in the wonderful state of Oregon, it is an acute embarrassment to have segregated clubs. It's an embarrassment to our community and our society.
Okay, from the floor.
Yes, I'm Charles Davis. I think you've talked about the process of selecting board members and have assumed that the process is not going to change. Clearly, the CEOs have a dominant role, and board members are beholden to the corporate management all across the country. There's no question about that. I'm wondering what's wrong with some government regulation of board selection, and if that's not a process that's going to work, what will enable boards to be better selection of persons to serve on boards.
I'll answer the first section of that. I would, considering the state that Washington and our federal budget's in, I'd hate to turn anything over to the government.
I would too.
I don't think that would, that would improve much.
And I would add, Charlie, that less is more in this case in terms of regulating who is on a board or how a board is selected. I would hate to see that happen.
So would I.
Well, I guess I'm not, if I'm entitled to a rejoinder, so long as nobody else is standing up here. I have a cross stitch that my daughter did for me, which says something to the effect that to be successful, women must be twice as good as men. And the second line says, fortunately, that's not too bad, not too hard to do. I think the evidence of the competence of American, of the boards of directors of American companies as performing their tasks with the kinds of skills that we ought to have, it's not very good. When you think of the number of decisions that seriously impacted our society made by the directors of the Ford Motor Company over the last 20 years, or General Motors and lots of others, it seems to me you can't just cavalierly suggest that the process for selecting directors now is a very good one. No more rejoinder from me. Thank you.
Charlie, I have a pillow that is cross-stitched that says, women are becoming the men they wanted to marry.
And I don't have any cross-stitch anything.
You guys think I'm going to touch this shirt? I would, Charlie, I do want to, however, respond to your statement about boards. I think that boards really do have a responsibility to the shareholders, and it is incumbent upon those boards to assume that fiduciary responsibility and to, again, I think the issue is boards don't do their homework, and they don't come in prepared to deal with the issues facing the company, and I think that needs to be changed in boardrooms across America. I don't think it necessarily has to do, maybe it has to do with selection, but I think board members really need to take their responsibility seriously. I will at this point commend our board for being tougher than most of us, or tougher than the officer group of my company is always comfortable with, and that is exactly how boards should operate.
From the floor.
City Club member McMurdo. I've been a longtime supporter of equal rights for women. You're probably familiar with the great statement from the Harvard professor who said, I support equal rights for women 100%. It's time we make the women equal to the men. They've been superior for too long. Now That is somewhat true. And I think many male board members are a little bit anxious about getting too many women on the board. Maybe they'll take over. And I think they should be represented in proportion to the population if they can prove worthy of them. And I think they're rapidly doing that. My question is, what are the board members doing to support equal rights for women and get that ratified?
Well, as a board, you mean, or as individuals?
In my company, I'll just speak for my particular company because it is, it holds true in my company and on the boards I serve. My company has a policy of pluralism and is absolutely outspoken in their support for women's rights and equal rights for people of regardless of sex, race, or religion. And the board really monitors us very closely on that.
Okay, we'll take another written question. This question has to deal with the American Leadership Forum. Two of you serve are fellows of that organization. Do they have a significant role to play in preparing women for service in the corporate boardroom?
I think it plays a significant role in helping both men and women serve, period. I think that there's a great deal that we need to learn about leadership in our community, and I think the leadership that's being done in the grassroots nonprofit organizations is as important, if not more important, than what's happening in the corporate boardroom. And to that end, the American Leadership Forum is certainly doing well for our state.
Additionally, the American Leadership Forum develops, one of the questions had to do with comfort levels. And what it tends to do is take a cadre of would-be leaders within a certain geographical location and gets them very comfortable with one another. And just in terms of how will they deal together in the future, the fact that they had the basis of the networking and the comfort zones of American Leadership Forum behind them, I think that they can, that the men and women who are involved think of one another as peers and much less as sex objects. I mean, what do you...
I'm
you
not
know.
Helping you out. You're
yeah,
on your own,
thanks
right?
a lot, Nancy. People of the other sex. Sex objects was not the right word. Was it?
That's great.
We'd like to thank our three panelists for being here today. I think we should give them a large, big round of applause. We are adjourned.